Game of Thrones episode 3, not called The Battle of Winterfell, called
The Long Night.
The Long Night. Time for the recap, reaction, and review. And man, I'm in shock. I can barely get through this intro. So why don't we just get to it? I'm Vidur.
And I'm Vikram.
Vikram.
Yes, sir.
We just rewatched the episode together.
Yep.
What is your pick one? Recap, reaction, or review? Pick one. Initial thoughts.
I'm so stunned. I didn't expect this from these guys that, you know, they'd sort of wrap up the Night's King sort of arc so quickly into the season. I mean, I know it's sort of midway, but episode 3 and they're sort of done with it. I'm still getting over it, man. I had the heebie-jeebies.
We discussed it a little bit and I definitely thought it was a possibility. I mean, when you've heard every theory, you've heard every possibility. But I tended to kind of believe this one because it's the Game of Thrones, you know? At the same time, a lot of people are pretty peeved that 8 seasons of build-up led to this.
Dude, the first ever shot of Game of Thrones was a white. First ever shot. And then every season, they just keep adding a little to the narrative, a little bit here, a little bit here, Craster, White Walkers, Night's King, what's happening, Bran. They just got done with it.
But my pushback to that is, this was an epic episode of television.
Did you say epic?
Yeah, I did mention epic. And if they had simply taken this battle and, you know, cut it across 4 episodes. I know that sounds crazy to think about now, but it's 80 minutes of battle, man. They could easily cut back to King's Landing, stretch it out, have more like talking in the crypts or whatever. That would have been kind of satisfying. They're like, oh my God, like after 8 seasons, you like spent 4 episodes on it. Instead, they gave you 80 minutes. It's like, yeah, okay, so they build something for 8 seasons, but then they give you a movie to wrap it up. It's like when Firefly wrapped up with Serenity. That was satisfying, right? It was a movie.
Well, that's a different thing. That was one season which got canceled out of nowhere. Also, you knew this was to be expected, that this was going to be battle dominated, because whenever these guys have shown battles, it's always been one scene. They're never usually cutting away from the battle in terms of like other places or in Westeros.
So Blackwater, Hardhome, Battle of the Bastards.
Battle of the Bastards. It's all that particular episode is always dominated by the battle. So I don't know, man. I don't know. I can't deal with it right now.
Okay, let's leave aside the repercussions of the episode and a little bit of like the recap and analysis. What is your reaction to the episode?
Well, obviously, it's completely dominated by the Night King and the outcome of the Night King and the Long Night, essentially. And I sort of lost my shit when Arya pulled that move, to be honest. I lost it, dude. Like, her just coming out of nowhere, just cut frame, and then, like, it's Arya just trying to jump on his back.
She comes out as though Doctor Strange opened a portal right behind the Night King, and she just jumped out into
it. Yeah. Although super cool, super short scene of a White Walker's hair sort of bristling
as
she goes by. Also, I mean, there's just so much to talk about, but like Arya doing it finally, essentially, is sort of my...
No, Arya doing it with the previous episode.
Arya stabbing the Night King is...
With the catpaw's dagger.
With the catpaw's dagger that Bran gave to her. Again, like, Bran sort of knows what's happening. He's like Doctor Strange from Endgame here, or Infinity War.
Yeah, and the dagger's been around since episode 2 as well. Like, yeah. Lyrian steel dagger has been going around.
Yeah.
The fact, if you rewatch Game of Thrones now, and you just trace, like, this is what's gonna end the Long Night, that's insane. And broadly speaking, like, forget the last scene, I think... The episode is an achievement, man. What an episode of television. They kept hyping it up. And I was like, they should be careful. They're hyping up this battle way too much.
Yeah.
They knew what they had in their pocket when they were hyping it.
Yeah.
That was insanely good when it comes to filmmaking, cinematography, music, the feels, even acting, which Game of Thrones is usually on top of. But, you know, just putting plot aside, everything else was like a 10 on 10, 20 on 10.
No, I completely agree with you. This one's going to get an Emmy for sure. And, you know, apart from all of the good things you said, the marketing as well. I agree that they hyped it up, but then
they didn't show anything.
They didn't reveal anything. There was no sort of, you had no idea what the outcome was going to be. Remember we were talking about it earlier. I was on the side that, you know, there's going to be some sort of retreat. These guys are going to get their ass handed to them. And no, nothing like that.
I can't wait to get to the wagers, man. I think I nailed a few things.
Like, you did, man. Yeah.
Overall, my favorite part of the episode was sort of like when things would calm down a little bit. And that would allow the tension to build. And I saw Dan and Dave talking about it in the inside the episode portion. And they were very self-aware. To like, listen, like a battle needs to happen this episode and it's going to be long. But at the same time, watching an 80-minute battle is not satisfying. So how they and the director, the same guy who made Hard Home and Battle of Bastards, how they juggled that tension and, you know, just the suspense, the music. This is better than, this is the longest battle ever filmed, right? Like more than movies, more than Return of the King, more than Helm's Deep. So you have essentially given a movie that's fully a battle. You know what that reminds me of? It's like Mad Max is one chase and you're interested throughout. Yeah. It's kind of like that.
Yeah. And all the tools of filmmaking applied brilliantly here. Like where to add what sort of score, how to sort of do the tension building, how to go completely quiet in that Arya library scene. It's everything was on point. It's just...
After this day, filmmaking will now be known as TV making.
This was filmmaking.
Steven Spielberg is going to be the greatest TV maker of all time.
I mean, an increased budget, which I'm assuming a movie would add to this, the only thing that would help with would be proper CGI, I guess, in terms of a few dragon scenes and maybe just some light correction overall.
Yeah, the lighting budget got sacrificed a little bit. I know it's on purpose. I know it's night. I know they lit everything or pretended to light everything using the fire, the dragon fire.
Right.
Amazing, amazing, unparalleled job done there. But the first part of the battle, not so visible.
Not so visible. And listen, why don't we just get into it, man?
Okay, let's get into it. Speaking of the first part of the battle, can we all take a moment of thanks to Melisandre for lighting up those Dothraki sword sickles, because it helped us actually see the battle for a moment. Until then, nothing was visible.
Also, talk about Melisandre. Where does she come from, man? She literally, it seems like she's walking from where the Knight's army is.
Yeah, I thought it was the Night King, dude, when she first came.
Yeah, I thought it was like some, like, you know, like some parlay scene where one White Walker comes and then you have to go talk to him and he's like, no, I'm going to kill you. Everyone here. But then it's Melisandre appearing out of nowhere and her first request is, please raise your swords.
Yeah, and she just demands it. Yeah. And Jorah's like, no, why? And then she's like, just tears him down until he's like, oh, okay, I'll do it.
Dude, but that scene, man, like when they show the Dothraki and the Unsullied and you actually for the first time sort of comprehend their numbers, magnificent. Especially with all the Dothraki sickles lighting on fire, that shot was beautiful.
Dude, one of 100 amazing shots. This one just kicked it off. And I have to say, the fire god comes through, man. I'm kind of a convertee, slowly.
I mean, yeah, I guess throughout the course of this episode, you sort of see what Melisandre's plan is. But she's been wrong so many times.
It doesn't matter, dude. The hit-miss ratio is pretty good when the hits are this big. I don't know. Like, I think we need to, like, give an offering to the Lord of the Light here.
Yeah, sure, man. I guess. Here, take my fire.
And then the Dothraki, man. What happens next? I feel like the episode almost doesn't allow you to comprehend what's happening, but... The Dothrakis are the most savage fighters on the planet.
They're going to rout you out.
Their reputation precedes them in every way. All of them, each and every Dothraki, the people that Danny got over from their chill homeland in Essos. In Essos, right?
Yeah.
They crossed the narrow sea only to be decimated in a matter of seconds.
Seriously, seconds. Although that shot, that aerial shot where from Danny and John's point of view of them advancing, that big blob of fire advancing towards the dark, that was pretty good. I think that was worth it.
Yeah, but then the wide shot, like the horizon shot, the Lawrence of Arabia shot, slowly the Dothraki fires just flicker out.
Not even slowly, it was pretty immediate.
Oh yeah, pretty immediate, quick, man. My mind was blown. Then this also, the episode doesn't let you really understand very well, but the plan just falls apart in the first minute. The Dothraki charge, I've heard plenty of reactions how it's horrible, horrible military tactic to send your cavalry.
But that's what their strength is. Like, their strength is not to sort of defend something that's oncoming. It's supposed to be attacking and hit head on, just colliding with whoever your force is. So
interesting. I didn't think about it that way, but they knew the numbers. Right, so it doesn't make any sense for the cavalry charge there just because their swords got lit. I think the Red Woman also hyped them up a little bit, like once their fires were lit, so they couldn't help it, like their natural
also
instinct.
Also, she left poor Jorah's sword without any fire. She could have just helped him out too.
He had the Valyrian steel, it didn't matter. And then the plan immediately falls apart. Yeah. Like Danny wants to get on a dragon and help, and she says something like, well, the dead are already here.
Yeah, I think that plan was to lure them in. Which again contradicts what the Dothraki charge was meant to
charge,
be.
Yeah,
It's just a cool cinematic shot. Let's just give it that. I really loved it.
You know, as we go through this, we'll have to finally discuss the plot and how much sense and the consistency of the episode. And I have to say, like, it's falling apart pretty early because everybody who knows anything about like military tactic and Game of Thrones tactics, even they think that the plan made no sense. Like, the living had no idea what the hell they were doing.
Yeah.
And that whole battle of Winterfell planning that happened in the previous episode, yeah. It kind of just makes no sense now that Bran was the bait, but, you know, they charge the Dothraki and then they get on the dragons. But anyway, it doesn't matter because Dany just cancels the plan anyway, gets on a dragon. The Dothraki are gone. I don't know why she's doing. Now she's rescuing the Unsullied, I guess, who are also her subjects.
Yeah, and then they finally show sort of Jorah returning with a few Dothraki here and there. You know what I was bummed about in that scene? No ghost. No ghost coming back.
Ghost is alive, though.
Do they show him?
I think they show him in the next episode preview.
Oh, thank God, man.
Well, thank God, but it's also kind of dumb that Ghost is alive.
Why? I mean, Jorah made it back.
Yeah, but it's also dumb. Yeah. Well, by the way, why did Jorah come back?
If Jorah makes it back, I'll bet on Ghost making it back too.
Okay, fair enough. But like, it's like they read all our YouTube comments being like, oh, where's Ghost? Stop spending your CGI budget on the dragons and bring us Ghost. And they're like, okay.
They gave us a small teaser last episode and this one's like, here, Ghost charging, not coming back the entire episode.
So Jorah retreats, and before the next attack happens, the snowstorm starts, which I think is like a real good use of the Night King's powers.
I mean, tell us what his powers are, man.
I mean, he can definitely control like winter if he can control the dead. He's
control
a Night King.
Control winter.
Can't he?
I mean, the only sort of indication of this is when they show the Night King army advancing, so the fog comes with it.
Yeah.
But like a full-blown snowstorm?
He went all mummy from The Mummy and The Mummy Returns.
Yeah, that was so Mad Max though.
It was Mad Max. It also reminded me of Mission Impossible 4 Ghost Protocol in Dubai.
the Dubai dust. Snowstorm.
But then we actually see whites for the first time. And it's not what we expected, is it? Like, for some reason, I always thought that, yeah, they come, they advance towards you, they're unstoppable. But I didn't think of them as this horde, this, like, stampede. Like, where do you even go from there?
Yeah, but think about it. Every time they've shown the whites attacking, they've literally been, like, really fast, completely ruthless in terms of just not caring about what's hitting them, what's not. So imagine 100,000 plus whites running at one particular target. That's exactly what I picture it to be.
Which brings me to a big question. How do any of them survive?
Yeah. I mean, they get dogpiled so much.
So right in the beginning, in this scene, when the whites charge, Samwell gets dogpiled immediately.
Yeah.
Okay, he's almost going to die. Ed saves him. Yeah. And then we get to death number one. Bye-bye, Ed. GG.
GG, Ed. They should have burned him. The guy asked for it specifically last episode, if
I
you remember.
Know, yeah. I know. We have to get to that. But yeah, they don't burn the dead at all. But
I guess
how
they don't
can
have
they,
time, yeah.
How can they have the time, right?
And then Brienne gets dogpiled. Jaime saves her. So everyone's just overrun immediately.
Brienne is a beast, dude. She's leading the charge.
Yeah.
And then Tormund's just standing on the side watching this happen before the whites reach him.
Complete shock.
He is a great point of view character to just think about what must be going through the other soldiers who are watching this happen, knowing that this is their fate as well.
And then he just turns and he realizes that that's going to happen to him any second now. That was a pretty cool scene.
So in the meanwhile, Theon is protecting Bran. I mean, nobody's reached them yet.
Yeah, but it's what a solid protective team.
Well, for now, it's just like a handful of Ironborn.
Yeah.
With a bucket full of arrows and another bucket full of fire.
And then I love how Bran's like, yeah, I'll be back. And then just walks out of there.
Oh, yeah. He's like, I gotta go now. Whoosh.
Also, he walks into these crows and then who eventually go and sort of seek out where the Night King is.
Are they crows or are they ravens?
Ravens, technically, I guess. And what I fail to understand is why isn't Bran doing this before? Why can't he go and scope out like the Knight's army so he can tell Jon where they're positioned, how they're positioned and all of that?
Yeah, because in the past, it used to be that if the Night King saw them do it, he would like kill the ravens or just continue the war or something. You remember that episode when that happens?
That happened once, yeah. No, the one with the raven specifically was the Night King turns his head towards the raven specifically. So he knows that Bran's walked into them.
Yeah.
So he knows.
Now
everyone knows. They all know. Like, just help the guys out, man.
Yeah. Bran was mighty useless in this episode, I have to say.
He's just sitting there, as always. First he was sitting in the courtyard, now he's sitting in the God's Wood. At least he's walking in this episode.
I thought he had all kinds of time travel and superpowers, and why was a lot of that established if none of it was going to be used, though?
I don't know. I thought the whole three-eyed raven sort of character fleshing out would be done intertwined with the Night King, but I guess they're going to do it in some other fashion now.
Yeah, I mean, I don't even know what happens next. Let's try and get to that. Up next, Daenerys is on the dragon. So she already rescues the Unsullied and stuff from the initial burst of the Whites. But then we start heading into the dragon fight territory. The one role she plays before that is that she has to light the trench. Now, this whole trench plan, it failed. It was always going to fail. Otherwise, why would there be any dramatic tension? But it wasn't much of a plan, was it?
And the fact that these guys expected that to be their last line of defense was, well, awful planning, given the experience they have with the whites and the White Walkers in general, right? Like, these guys have seen what they're capable of beyond the wall, and they know how many there are in number. So this whole relying on the trench plan to, what were they expecting? Like a trench fire and then everyone just standing either side of it, and then what?
So Davos does his one role in the battle, which is waving torches like he's bloody...
He's the air traffic controller, man.
Yeah, or he's like Nicolas Cage in The Rock, just like for waiting for the planes to come. Yeah. And then he's signaling Danny, like any good air traffic.
Who's just like hovering around somewhere up there.
Yeah, so he's a dragon traffic controller. And Danny fails because of the snowstorm. And the snowstorm also actually doesn't allow them to burn it using their arrows, because they could have lit the trenches with arrows. It would have taken much longer.
Yeah.
So when you need fire and you need something that the Lord of Light provides, who walks in and comes to the rescue? But
literally,
once again,
literally walks in.
Oh, she takes her time.
She's casually walking.
She glides in.
And you know, the other thing I didn't understand is just before that scene, they show John and his dragon landing near the Godswood, just, I guess, to sort of check in on Bran and see what he's doing.
Yeah.
And the trench is right next to him.
Oh, is it?
Why doesn't he just use his dragon to...
It's not part of the plan. There's a lot of cross-connection.
These small holes, man. Like, these small holes just keep creeping up here and there.
I know. It doesn't make much sense often, but you can let a lot of that go, just being like, you know, this is the plan. For instance, with Jon, his job is to protect Bran, right? And with the army there, like, his focus is Bran being protected or not? He can't just trust Theon to do it. Also, and we'll get to this, he's just waiting to use that dragon fire on the Night King. That's his whole goal here.
Yeah, I guess that's what Danny and his plan was throughout, to sort of just provide any sort of support they could, but primarily focus on the Night King.
I liked when Melisandre is trying to light the trench and it doesn't light. And I get it. It's purely for dramatic tension. There's no reason it shouldn't light.
But she looks scared, dude.
She looks scared. She actually looks like her faith is wavering, because the Lord of Light has let her down so many times.
Yeah.
Just like her prophecies haven't come true, and Stannis. And who else did she support? Danny, I guess, at some point.
Yeah, whoever she can find.
Yeah, and so now it's almost like this is her final test. She's like, I saw myself dying. I saw myself doing all this. Is it actually going to happen? Last moment, trenches light up. Big fat user is, man. The dead instantly build a dead bridge.
They had a plan, dude.
They didn't have a plan.
Oh.
The Night King manipulates them.
Yeah. He's doing his puppet thing from on top of the dragon.
So the dead are like, what's that like? It's like they have a default mode. So the Night King sets them to default. It's like walk and kill. But then anytime some brain is needed, they just pause and wait. And they wait for the Night King to actually tell them what to do.
Feels like some sort of telepathy going on there.
Obviously, it is telepathy. He raises them from the dead. He's basically walking 100,000 people at a time.
Yeah. That's actually what it is exactly. So I'm guessing he knows exactly what to do in terms of control. But yeah, they just literally sit on top of the trench one by one till the fires are extinguished. And they cover all the dragon glass. And they just create a... sort of a bridge, I guess.
A zombie bridge.
Yeah.
So then it becomes a little World War Z-like, don't you think?
Yeah, especially when they show them climbing on the wall. That's particularly from that one scene in World War Z.
Yeah, when they're in like Palestine or Israel or whoever, they build that wall. And then we get to sort of the close quarters part of the battle within the castle, starting with Arya. And Arya is in full ninja mode here, dude.
Dude, this is the first time we actually see her in like action, if you think about it. Otherwise, it's always been like one-on-one or like her ultimately just killing someone. This is her actually fighting a lot of people.
All she needed was a yellow suit and a sword by Hanzo, Hanzari, whatever the name of the guy in Kill Bill is. She was just reminding me of Kill Bill, dude.
She also needed some action, bro.
What?
She needed some action. She needed to get some pent up sort of sexual tension out of the way before she could
full... That's what unlocked this, you think?
Yeah.
What a one-track mind you had.
But she killed it, dude. That one sequence was amazing.
She was doing like her water dancing, Silvio.
And then Davos just standing there staring at her.
Oh, yeah. Davos is so useless. He's just staring there in awe. But it's actually cool to have a point of view character like that. And she doesn't even care who's staring at her. She's just thwack, thwack, thwack,
yeah,
thwack.
Just
killing.
On, yeah.
But eventually... She escapes there, but she kind of starts getting overcome by them slowly.
Also, I think she gets hit really hard on the head.
That's after she gets chased by the whites. And I think that's a big one. She actually gets a little disoriented by that. They cut away to the Hound just being super coward, pussy as always
old
when
Hound,
it comes to fire.
Yeah, and then just scared shitless. And then when Beric tries to go and basically snap
so again,
him out.
We need you.
Like, and he snaps at him so
like,
hard.
Shut up, you whore. You stupid whore.
Sandor's character, man. The lines he uses are hilarious.
But the way that Beric inspires her is just pointing towards Arya just solo fighting.
Just changes it. And that's also because earlier in the episode, they show Sandor retreating into Winterfell and Arya actually saves him. So Sandor acknowledges that. So he has this thing of like, I really respect Arya and I owe her as well. So as soon as he sees Arya in action, he's like, if that little girl can do it, then I'm sure I can do something for her too.
Which is why soon after he sacrifices himself for her. And you were pointing out how when they're in the castle and they're using Beric's sword to look for whites, how dumb it is for them to walk
they're
slowly.
They're creeping around. The dude has he literally has a torchlight, like the shiniest torchlight ever. And he's creeping around like corners and just seeing if there's anyone there. Just run, man. I think you should just run like flashing
swish,
a sword.
Swish.
Yeah. And like if you connect with someone, great. If you don't, then that means there's no one there, which is great again.
Be that as it may, Beric dies a very stabby death. I don't like how he keeps getting stabbed and manages to keep up with
Arya. Yeah, that happens with a few people.
Yeah, but I guess whatever. Dramatic leeway. He makes it outside the door. He passes away. Can't say anything. Death number two. GG. Beric Dondarrion.
Well played, well played.
Seventh GG.
Yeah.
But this one finally final. And who's standing there? But the Red Woman just chilling.
She just knows where to be, man. At what time?
Yeah, she's just like intersecting like the timelines. And she's like, oh, I have to be here next. Yeah. Let me go there. I have to be here next. Let me go here.
And she's there. And then she literally, well, she says that this is the reason Beric was brought back to life all these times. And this was the purpose.
She doesn't say that directly. She's just like, now he has fulfilled his purpose. And you don't know exactly what she's talking about. Now we know.
Yeah.
Now it makes a lot of sense. At the time, I was like, oh, I guess he just fought and saved Arya and fought for Winterfell. Okay. But then she gives her a little fire priestess prophecy, which she's given in the past too to Arya. That was the first time they met. And Arya hated her because she was mean to Gendry, I guess.
Super
she was
mean.
On Arya's list.
Yeah.
And she says, brown eyes, green eyes, blue eyes. Now, we know what the blue eyes stands for. Arya somehow gets it and just goes away. And she's like, BRB.
Yeah.
But does Cersei have green eyes?
Who Cersei has green eyes. So the brown eyes was
Walder Frey. You think?
Yeah. I mean, so she's killed so many people that there have bound to be brown, black, blue, green eyes people.
You know but who else has blue eyes, by the way? Melisandre.
Melisandre. So when she actually said this prophecy, everyone thought that Melisandre was a blue-eyed person she'd be killing.
Yeah.
But in terms of like major characters, this is what the theory alludes to or the prophecy alludes to. So yeah, I like to believe that green eyes might be Cersei. Cersei's definitely on top of her list. And
wouldn't that be too much of a reveal, though?
I don't know, man.
If Arya gets to kill the Night King and Cersei, that's too much.
Dude,
Cersei is on a list, though.
Cersei is top of her list, if you think about it. She's number one, like, she's the number one target on the list. So that could be it. And then also Melisandre sort of goes back to this one line that her teacher, Syrio Ferrell, used to say. And that, I think...
What do we say to deaths?
Not today. And that is sort of the trigger for Arya to just scurry off and be like, yeah, I'll be right back.
Right. Not
then
today.
Then you know what Arya... Like, what Arya knows what Arya's purpose is. Obviously, the viewers don't. But she goes with the purpose.
Dude, Maisie Williams must be on top of the world today. For everyone to just see Arya be the biggest badass.
Yeah.
And she's done such a good job of... Everyone has of, like, not giving away spoilers and stuff. For me to now realize that Maisie Williams had this knowledge in her back pocket is insane, man. Insane.
And these guys, the creators, knew this for 3 years.
They knew that
Arya is going to be the one who's going to take that final shot in the Night King. That's crazy, man.
That's what they said. And why don't we talk about it when we get to that final shot? But it's pretty crazy. I get it. It's the right subversion of expectations. Let's talk about it in a bit. Coming back to the Night King, he now takes front and center with the dragon. So I didn't realize this. I thought he was just attacking Winterfell willy-nilly with dragon fire. And I was like, holy shit, he's going to do Winterfell what he did to the wall, which would be really sad. I was like, Winterfell is just going to be in ruins at the end of the episode, not even knowing where it's going to go. But he was actually just opening up the gate for the whites to actually attack.
Right.
And so they do. Suddenly the siege of Winterfell is on with the dead inside them. Who's facing the siege front up? Miss Lyanna Mormont.
Dude, Lyanna Mormont, man.
Goes out like a boss.
Super boss. Like, and you know, like, the entire way her character's build up, you sort of expected it, but not like this.
I don't know. I don't know what to expect. I thought she looked stupid fighting.
No, man. Like, she always had that thing in her. So you knew that if she would fight, at some point she would kick ass. But
that
she
scream?
Literally...
Do you remember the scream she gave? Oh, it's
and
gut.
She got a punch from a giant before that. So she could barely get up. She was like half deformed and she's still screaming with a dragon cast blade running towards a dead giant.
The giant, a little conveniently, decides to pick her up and examine her like he's King Kong. And
was
she's
he about to eat her? I thought he was about to eat her.
No, I thought it was like King Kong and Naomi Watts. You know, I think he was falling in love with her a little bit. And what does she do?
Oh, but you could hear her ribs cracking.
Oh, God, dude. That was so
gnarly,
sad.
Dude, so gnarly.
But she stabs him in the eye and she kills a giant, competing with Tormund, by the way. Yep. I don't know how old Lyanna is, but it's like a real hold my beer. Tormund's like, oh, I killed a giant at the age of 10. And Lyanna's like, yeah, screw you, I killed a dead giant.
GG, Lyanna, GG.
Oh, GG, Lyanna. That's number 3, I believe we're at.
And next we have something that I was anticipating a lot. I kind of expected it. Everyone expected it. But Dragonoff, man. Dragon dogfight.
Wait, before we get to that, the scene where the dragons are above the clouds, that was beautiful.
Beautiful,
man.
Yeah. I think that was like 80% of the dragon CGI budget. That shot of
that
them
shot
just going up.
That shot was just amazing. And I've never thought about the fact how they can go above the clouds. Can they breathe up there?
Well, it's not just the clouds. It's also them going above the snowstorm as well, right?
Oh, that might be it, actually.
So clear skies, essentially. That's what they tried to show. Because the shot of them going up was them following the dragon. So as soon as they saw stars, and then the white pan out shot of the two dragons in the sky.
And the moon at the back.
Yeah, that was beautiful.
Glorious.
That was really good.
And then finally we get to your Dragonoff, too.
Dude, Dragonoff, man. Because these guys are literally like trying to see where the Night King is with his dragon. And he just comes from the snowstorm, dragon fire, whatever it is, blazing.
And they've never seen Viserion the blue before.
They haven't. Yeah, that's actually their first encounter.
It's mind-boggling. Like, the fact that we just saw three dragons fight it out full force in the night, in the air, John riding one and Danny riding one. We're taking all of this for granted, dude. Yeah. Like, 2 weeks ago, this was unimaginable.
Yeah, yeah. And then that dragon fight was actually well shot. You know, the things that I liked about this episode was, even though it was on purpose, obviously super dark, and they sort of wanted to touch upon what was happening in terms of size and scale, but not make it super clear. There's this one great shot of the Unsullied just holding their ground and the Knight's army advancing towards them.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very dark, it's very grainy, but you can sort of make out how many people are involved. And the same thing with the dragon fights, right? Like, it's all in the snowstorm. It's not completely clear, yet it's clear. You know the Night King's holding his spear. The Viserion actually ends up biting away Jon's cloak.
Yeah.
Which was super crazy. And it's so evident that that happens. It's not something that's tough to make out. I think they did a really good job.
For the most part, you can follow everything, which is amazing. Actually, that's more than I can say for the ending of Endgame, you know, in the crazy battle. So super props to them. The fight between the dragons was so, I don't know what the right word is, like natural, gut. Drill, visceral, I'm blanking.
Yeah.
But my point is, like, if you watch the Discovery channels and if you see, like, hyenas go after each other, or, like, I saw one where a pack of hyenas attacks a lion.
Yeah.
And it's kind of the same. Like, you go and you just, like, peck, like, and go for, like, quick bites. And the dragons are doing exactly that to each other. And Viserion kind of gets his ass handed to him because Dany comes to the rescue.
Yeah, I mean, up until that, I felt like Rhaegal was getting his ass handed to him by Viserion.
Actually, we don't know what the end result of Rhaegal was, right?
Well, not really, but we saw him in the preview for the next episode. They show a quick clip of the two dragons, but he has to be super injured because he gets really injured. I think he does damage to Viserion as well in terms of just biting into his neck and his throat. So we start seeing like fire coming out of
his neck. Oh, yeah. That's so crazy.
But then for the most part, like the Night King and Viserion sort of whoop Jon's ass.
Until Drogon comes, Dany comes, and she's anyway better dragon rider, of course, than Jon.
Practice
and just anger plus... You know, I thought they might focus on how she feels bad because it's Viserion. Because, like, we always talk about, well, what if Gendry comes back from the dead, like, as a white, like, how brutal that is. That's happening to Dany with one of her children, technically. She hasn't seen Viserion since then. They don't focus on that at all.
And then
they just have
that nice shot of the Night King falling off his dragon.
That's what she does. She knocks the Night King off, and the Night King seems completely unworried.
He's fine,
zero
man. He's
bleeds
fine.
Given.
Obviously, he's calmly descending to the earth where he's waiting.
He's waiting to be roasted by dragon fire. Dany finds him. They pause. She gives him the biggest Dracarys on the show till date.
Yep.
He takes it head on. Face first.
Yeah. Just standing there. No qualms. No worries.
John is watching from the side. What do you think was going to happen in that scene?
Dude, I kind of expected him not to.
Just narratively, because it's happening in the middle. The fact it can't be over.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you what you didn't expect.
What?
is him smiling after that.
Oh my god.
When he's unfazed.
He has emotions now?
Yeah, I didn't know that. He always had anger.
Well, they never really showed. He always had expression the entire time, no matter what's happening.
He had smugness.
Not really, not in his face.
That hard home lifting people from the dead, he looked pretty smug.
No, literally he had the same expression except his hands were going up.
Oh, except we were eating into it.
Yeah.
Well, then why does he have a mouth? He has to use it for something.
To smile at Danny, dude. Jesus Christ.
That smile, dude. I can only imagine the number of memes that are going to be created from that smile.
So he tries to spear Danny. Danny runs away. Then he just continues smiling, turns around, starts walking towards Winterfell. And John's great plan, surrounded by dead bodies,
John's
is to
plan
run after him.
Everything is to run after them. Since the Battle of the Bastards, since Ardo.
Not the sharpest, nah? Or Jon Snow?
Not the sharpest. No, he's not. He just hopes for the best. And he just starts running after Night King. Night King notices, turns around. John stops in his tracks, being like, if he knows I'm here, I should be a little careful. And he should be, because he does the hard home, raising both his hands.
The only thing around both of them are dead bodies. The only thing around them is dead bodies. So obviously he resurrects the dead.
Not just the dead bodies around him, but also the people in the crypts. This is now something we've been thinking about for a long time, is how the crypts are a really, really bad place to hide when you're fighting a guy who can raise the dead. Hey, why don't we go to the place where they bury all the dead to hide from the guy who can raise them? That's smart.
No, not sharp at all, man. Like, just... And you know, these guys also build up the crypts a lot in terms of...
The trailer,
the marketing, the positioning and stuff like that. So you knew something was going to happen at the crypts. It wasn't just going to be the sort of safe keep version of Winterfell, but... Yeah, Death Stark's rising.
Did you say Ned Stark or Death Stark?
Death Stark's.
Well, everyone except Ned Stark seemed to be rising. And Lyanna.
I was kind of waiting to see a dead Lyanna in that situation. Just bones.
You know, talking about the crypts, we actually didn't talk about the previous times they cut away to the crypts, which is Sansa bringing Tyrion back to the ground, where he's all just itching to be in the battle, being like, oh, you know, Blackwater, you know, that one time.
I found the mudgate, and then, yeah.
And Sansa's like, you wouldn't do jack shit. You would
Shut
die.
Up, sit down.
And then she actually faints. She's like, I think the only thing we can do right now, sitting quietly in the crypts, is at least face the truth, at least add truth to the world.
Yeah. I think that was a good line.
And he just, he takes it.
He takes it, obviously, because he has alcohol with him.
That's true. He just keeps drinking. But I think that also just, I guess, establishes why Tyrion needs to respect Sansa even more. They start sort of from scratch, build up this Sansa-Tyrion connection. What do you think about that?
You know, I didn't mind it, actually. I usually mind it whenever situations like that or scenes like that are sort of forced into...
people getting together.
Yeah, and like in situations like those, especially when they sort of shoehorn a scene like that. But I honestly didn't mind it.
At the time, all I was worried about is what the hell is happening to John, because John was surrounded by whites. And this happens a lot, man. They cut away from scenes and moments when the person that you're rooting for should not survive at all when you cut back.
They did that so many times in this
episode. I swear. So now John is surrounded by, like, I don't know, 50 whites. And then you cut back and he's just fighting them one by one, and they're attacking very conveniently one by one. I guess that happens a lot these days in Game of Thrones. But the point is, he's about to go down, and who's he rescued by but Danny, who I guess took a loop, saw that Night King doesn't have any spears left, came back and rescues John. John decides to go into the castle now. He is just worried about Bran. That's his one motive. The plan is, he knows where the Night King's
focus.
Going.
And all of the while this is happening, Danny decides to land with a dragon and just stay at that spot.
So dumb. That was like beyond the wall level dumb.
And she's just looking at John as if like,
why did she land?
I don't know, man. And she had no sort of idea. Obviously she had an aerial view, so she knew that there were dead all around her. And then these dead just conveniently come and start ripping apart Drogon.
100 whites just stabbing Drogon. Poor Drogon.
Dude, Drogon and Rhaegal both are super injured for the next episode.
Which actually we should talk about, because Cersei is killing it in this episode without lifting a finger. So Drogon, for some reason, doesn't fly away until he's just like, I was imagining Drogon's internal monologue then. And he's like, get off me. There's ants all over me. And then he just decides to take off, dislodging Danny. Actually dislodges Danny first, then takes off.
Or I think Danny gets knocked off because of a white as well. But Drogon, as soon as that happens, decides that this is the time to fly off. Yeah. I don't know why. So he just like
leaves Danny
in the lurch.
So now Danny's on the ground for the first time. And she's about to die from whites. Of course, we know she won't. And of course, we should know who's going to rescue her. But Sir Jorah Mormont defends his Khaleesi.
Yeah, man. But there's just so many convenient sort of...
almost moments.
Yeah, almost saved by this one character who you've had a great character arc with throughout the show.
But dude, tell me, while watching the episode, we didn't mind it.
I was minding stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, especially like small stuff, you know, like that actually in my mind stitches together these great sort of moments or situations, like John next to the trench, Jorah coming to save her just in the nick of time, Danny coming to save him in the nick of time. You sort of now, it's become a thing where you can predict that that's going to happen.
That's true, that's true.
Which just takes away from the whole battlefield of it.
But I think to expect anything else would be to expect too much. At the end of the day, maybe it's just me, but, you know, the filmmakers and the showmakers, the showrunners, they have to also maximize, like, the juice you get out of it. And I think just the way storytelling works and dramatic tension and 80 minutes of television works, if they don't do that and they keep subverting expectations, either they kill everyone, which they can't, or they actually won't end up with such an impactful, like, just, you know, dramatic episode. So they're actually going for the drama repeatedly. I agree with you. Maybe a little too often.
Yeah, you're right, man. But usually, if you think about it, Game of Thrones up until season 5 or season 6, these sort of dramatic episodes always used to be episode number 9, the one before the last episode where the war or the fight sequence or these dramatic tensions used to come. I guess these guys are just sort of now have no choice but to do that every
this
episode.
This whole season is episode number 9. And well, the first two episodes were not, and we were complaining about that kind of. So now we really can't.
So yeah, I guess I gotta let these small sort of quips go.
Plus it's Jorah, man. Who is he gonna die for if not Danny? Like, this was always in the cards. You knew the moment Danny comes into trouble, Jorah has to appear from somewhere to come and rescue her. And that scene, like, Jorah is giving it his all, dude. He's getting stabbed, he's getting slit.
Yeah, you thought like the whole Beric death was outrageous. This guy gets like, he gets double the wounds easily.
But from Jorah, I believed it. For Danny, Jorah dies in the friend zone.
Dude, there's this one scene where Jorah literally is on his knees and he can't, like, his legs have given way. He's obviously still fighting and killing people. And then he turns. Instead of attacking a white, he just takes one in the chest.
He just takes it, yeah.
In the chest.
I swear to you, when I was watching it.
And he still kills that white.
Dude, you know, we have to watch the episode super early in the morning, right? When I was watching it, for some reason, I thought Danny actually twisted him and used him as a shield. And I would have actually been proud of Danny if she did that. Cause, you
and
know,
Jorah.
That's the right use of Jorah in that moment, for sure.
But yeah, I can see that. I remember that scene, the placement, and how they both sort of turned together.
Can we also say Danny picks up a sword and defends herself? She's never ever done that before.
Yeah.
And it looks awkward, and it should look awkward, and she does the best. And, you know, it actually shows, like, what people do and what they have to do in the time of battle, which I appreciate it. So now it happens like Nolan style, like all these battles are happening at once. Jon is now trying to get to the Night King. The Night King has almost reached the Weyward, which means whose time is it to shine?
Well, Theon Greyjoy and his handful of Ironborn with that.
Forget the handful.
Handful of arrows.
It's all Theon.
It is all Theon. I mean, obviously, firstly, that plan. Why arrows in that situation? Why not like swords and shields and like what, or like half arrows, half swords? Cause they're gonna overrun you, man, pretty quickly.
Yeah, the arrows didn't make any sense. So then finally when Theon picks up his spear, only then he actually whoops ass, man.
He whoops ass.
What a redemption, dude.
Yeah.
What a redemption arc. And I think, I've seen a lot of YouTube comments where they say that the genius of Game of Thrones can be seen in the character of Theon, where they made you not care about him, then hate him during Winterfell's when he takes over, then feel bad for him and Reek, then be okay with him and now love him and root for him.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah, he has a tremendous arc, man. And all of this time, Jon's obviously trying to get to the God's Word to try to save Bran.
But he can't because he's been blocked by Viserion.
And just before that, they do this cut shot of him just crossing all of these name characters and sort of seeing what they're up to. And then there's this one scene where Sam is overrun by, like, he's dogpiled eternity.
I know what you're talking about, and he leaves him to die.
There's this split second where he turns and you think that he's about to go save Sam, and he's like, no, screw this, man. I don't got time for this, dude. I need to get to that Godswood ASAP.
That's crazy, dude. What a great way to show where Jon is at in that scene, in that moment. Yeah. Nothing could tell you more about Jon's priorities than leaving Sam to die. When he could clearly have done something.
Yeah, he could have just gone back, saved him from getting overrun, but he literally doesn't have a second to waste.
I also remember this one, I don't even know what the editing term is, but it's like a transition that happens from Tyrion to Jon, because Tyrion and Sansa are in the crypts and the crypts are being overrun by the dead and everybody there is useless. So they're just getting trampled over. They have no defense whatsoever. Sansa and Tyrion have that beautiful moment. I didn't mind their relationship either. Technically, it's well established from like seasons and seasons ago, But they have that beautiful moment. He kisses her on the hand.
Yeah.
And that just says everything that they need to say. And they both decide they're not going to die like wimps.
Well, yeah, they pull out their knives and then you think that Tyrion's about to go charge.
But... And that's when they do the transition. Tyrion goes to charge and then you cut to Jon charging. And I think that's when Viserion comes and blocks him and he becomes pretty useless from that point on in the story.
I think if you think about it, the Night King having power over all his subjects, he specifically placed Viserion there to stop Jon from coming to the Godswood or to stop anyone to come from the Godswood. And Viserion's the best defense if you think about it.
True, true.
It's like fire. And Jon tries multiple times to sort of run up to him, slash him with his sword or whatever, but it doesn't work eventually until Jon just gives up.
Yeah, and he's just hiding, like, I don't know, it seems so very un-John-like, but I guess that's the point. Like, he's just cornered, he can't do anything, and the frustration starts to build. Meanwhile, the Night King makes real quick work of Theon, who really shouldn't have been charging. I think, you know what, Bran tells him, thank you, and what do you say, like, you're a hero, you're a good man.
You're a good man. And then before that, that exchange as well in terms of you're here now, you're
home. This is home. That's
so
true.
I think that was like Theon's true redemption there, right?
That's it, full redemption. And he's just like, there's no point in me living now, so let me just charge
the
Night
King. What could he do? Honestly, what could he do?
He could run the other way.
That would have been very Theon-y. But yeah, he's not going to do that. He's surrounded by not just whites, but like White Walkers and the Night King.
Yeah.
With a spear. So he does whatever true redemption leads you to, which is self-sacrifice.
Yeah, that's right. And he dies heroically. I thought he had some life left in him, but then the Night King stares him down until he doesn't.
Yeah.
And I was like, all right, Theon. Like, you face the Night King, you went out like a hero. Good for you, man. But then it's like the all is lost moment.
Yeah.
And I had mixed feelings about this because when there's an all is lost moment, it's always followed by some Deus Ex Machina of some sort.
Yeah.
They went slow-mo. They went like sad music. The background score was amazing.
The all is lost moment, everything, the cinematography, the soundtrack, everything was spot on.
For all is lost.
Because they're just cutting to all of these people getting overrun by dead everywhere. The crypts, the battle outside, the walls, everything. Everyone was just dying. There were dead people flying. Did you notice all the dead people flying?
Oh, yeah. All
the
time.
Dead, dude. It was amazing. Yes. It's like dead people just falling off. Like, they're just flying. They were like raindrops.
That's half the reason Jon couldn't get to where he wanted to as well. The Night King slowly comes to Bran, does the face-off. Bran is just quiet. Also, his wheelchair is pointed the wrong way, so he's like looking to the side.
Doesn't even bother, man. Bran,
he has like a good side, I guess.
Yeah, and also it feels like they have an exchange.
Like a telepathic exchange?
Yeah, because it's not like they're just staring each other, but like the Night King also tilts his neck the other way. So it's as if they're communicating, man. That was pretty cool. That's why I'm so curious to see what the Three Eyed Raven's actually capable of, because it's so murky.
I don't know. I felt like they were just facing off like the slow motion, like Western, just staring at each other before one of them kills the other. I didn't read much into that, and that's kind of weak because what happens next is that Arya comes flying out of a Doctor Strange-like portal.
Yeah.
Apart from the Nightwalker whoosh that you see.
Yeah. Do you think she was like, she had a dead's face on or something? She was just like...
No, don't give the show too much credit. They would have shown that if she did that. Although that would have been awesome. If
they actually show, she come out of no, I guess she can.
She can because it's a show. The thing that I like in all this is to solve these situations with cleverness, which they didn't do. They just solved it with Arya Ex Machina, which I didn't like at all. But you know, it's still cool. It's still cool because Arya kills the Night King.
The blade, the move. They showed that move. She pulled that move on Brienne as well. So everything about that was pretty cool in terms of how the Night King dies and who eventually kills him, which was the biggest shocker ever.
And then whoosh, one stab, and it's all over.
They all gone?
One of the funniest memes I saw was a cutaway to Gimli saying that still counts as one when all the Night King's army disappears.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's really good.
But like Jon, man. Jon, like the entire time, he literally gave up by the end of it. He stood up and he's like, just burn me, bro. I'm done. I can't do anything.
Can you explain that to me? What was his plan?
He was done.
What do you mean he was done?
He'd lost all hope. He literally lost all hope. It was like that Lyanna Mormont sort of scream.
Didn't he have a sword made of Valyrian steel? Shouldn't he be trying to like...
He did.
Stab the dragon?
He did. That's what all he was doing. Steel. That was this one cut where he tried to run up to the dragon and the dragon turns around to him. So he runs back behind the rock. So he was just hiding behind that rock the entire time until he's like, dude, I'm done.
That I found that moment really stupid because that to me is like, as an audience, you know something good is going to happen. When Jon is doing something so stupid that should kill him. Whatever. I guess
the whole Game of Thrones would have killed him.
No, they, yeah, I mean, and brought him back to life. So, like,
or whatever, they would have killed, like, that would have been the death of at least that Jon Snow.
Yeah, yeah, the death, I mean, the Long Night is one.
It was pretty quick, dude.
It lasted like 2 hours, the
it
Long
Night.
It
wasn't even that long, yeah. And then we have, obviously, the final GG, I guess, which was Melisandre.
Oh, wait, did we have some GG till now? Jorah Mormont, GG.
Yeah, we GG'd him, don't worry.
Oh, we did?
Yeah. And then obviously, Melisandre, who previously in the episode says that I'll be dead by dawn, just walks out.
Just commits snow suicide?
I don't even know what it is with her, man. She just, like, takes off her necklace thingy and just, like,
withers. She takes
away.
Off the magic necklace, so yeah. Now she's 1,000 years old yeah. In the winter. You last, like, 2 minutes doing that.
Okay.
She just, like, boom.
But I thought she wasn't supposed to feel cold.
Yeah,
is that a necklace power?
Who knows?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but she... GG, yeah. Melisandre.
GG, finally, man. Finally, you actually predicted something that was right.
And incited Arya into killing the Night King.
Yeah. Do you think Arya's Azor Ahai?
No, I don't. I just think the show is, like, not beholden to any of that stuff. I know Melisandre had an Azor Ahai prophecy. The fact that she pushed Arya into this implies some Azor Ahai thing, but they could just as well just let that thread go and never look back into it.
And do you think Bran was truly like a Doctor Strange in terms of he knew what the outcome was going to be? Because he gave Arya that knife.
But it's tough, right? Like, even Doctor Strange knew what the outcome was going to be, and that's why I saved Iron Man's life.
Right.
So it's kind of the same thing.
So he knew, like, what this one possible outcome, essentially.
And he guided people to it.
By just sitting in the God's Word.
It's all whatever, dude.
Also,
you know how it is.
He's literally walking the entire time up until the Night King literally comes 2 feet away from
yeah,
him.
Yeah, to do what?
I don't know.
I don't know.
They only show him, like, with those ravens in the beginning. But, like, what was he doing the rest of the time? Just, like, flying around?
Sometimes I have hopes that when Game of Thrones sets something like this up, that they'll actually pay it off at some point. But then again, given how they paid off the Night King and the fact that the Night's army is now dead, I don't know if they'll pay anything off. Broadly speaking, I still like the episode. I still think it was a fantastic hour of television.
Dude, I don't know about that, man. I feel like this is now, at least after this episode, just become true, like, popcorn TV, essentially. I just hope, like, the last three episodes, they...
Wait. You say popcorn TV, but what else compares? What else is popcorn TV? TV has never been popcorn level until
now. I never wanted Game of Thrones to be popcorn. I love Game of Thrones season 1 through 5, where it's actually the politics and who's going to rule and all of that. So I hope, like, they sort of redeem themselves in these last three episodes.
They've set themselves up to redeem themselves by now going back to the game of the Game of Thrones.
It's been a while since they did. It's been a season and a half since they did this. So I hope they still have the chops for that, man.
But you know what? I actually do agree with you with the popcorn TV thing, because now that I'm thinking about it, the greatest show before this, at least in modern times, was Breaking Bad, you know, a show with this much hype. Actually, the hype of Breaking Bad didn't even compare to Game of Thrones, but I was watching Breaking Bad during the time the Breaking Bad finale aired, and that finale is amazing, because that finale had so good, but the Ozymandias episode that preceded it by two episodes was almost considered like a finale for the show, because it was that good. And Ozymandias completely maintained the vibe of Breaking Bad, whereas the finale upped it a notch, involved some machine guns and rattling guns, and also, you know, just Walter White getting away with everything and nicely tying things up in a nice little knot. Here, I agree with you. Maybe there was a way for them to maintain the vibe of old Game of Thrones and wrap it up. But you know what? The show has always been building up to some epic fantasy shit, and now we got it, and I can't really complain too much, man. When you do this good a job, it's hard for me to complain.
Yeah, I think so too. I can't wait for the next three episodes, man. Because if they choke now, it'll be the worst choke in TV history.
So true.
In TV history. I feel like these guys have given us enough confidence to make us feel like they won't choke. But if they do, man,
I would be so pissed. Watch that inside the episode. They know what's up. They are just manipulating us like a puppet. So they know how to make us feel things. I have a lot of confidence in them. I'm pretty optimistic. What do you think is next?
Cersei.
Let's go.
Cersei destruction, dude.
Turns out Cersei's the end boss, man. Yeah, like the Night King. He's the tiny Bowser. And Cersei is like the big bad Bowser.
Dude, man. I was so hoping. Well, I guess I set myself up for failure. Because I was hoping that there would be some sort of Cersei-Night King sort of... Cersei never sees the Night King or the Army of the Dead now. Like, she never interacts with it.
I know, that's so messed up. They'll only write songs about this. Who will be able to express what exactly happened here?
I don't know. I guess Sam?
Yeah, Sam was on the battlefield, but Cersei played her cards just right. What else would you do in a situation? Now, Danny's army is just struggling.
Yeah.
According to the next episode preview, they're just going for it in terms of taking Cersei on.
Without the Dothraki, half the Unsullied, two wounded dragons.
And everybody else is tired as hell. Just
dead people. And then, yeah, tired. Otherwise, the remaining alive people are tired. It's the worst. I thought the Starks were like battle-hardened, sort of really strategic people. But this is the worst idea to attack Cersei now.
Why is she so confident, Danny?
I don't know, man. It feels like she's gone off the deep end in terms of just drunk with power and rage. Like, she's becoming more and more of her father and she was trying to stay away. Like, remember her in Meereen? She was all this savior and compassion and this and that. And now she's just like, rage. I'm going to kill everyone in my sight.
I can't blame her for having a lot of adrenaline, though, after this battle. They did win. They won the Battle of Winterfell.
Well, yeah, this battle obviously seems like the bigger one. That's why in the preview she says that we've won the Great War, now it's time to win the last war.
So Arya won the Battle of Winterfell, Dany shouldn't really be proud. She was done for.
Everyone was done for. Everyone was going to die if Arya hadn't done what she did. So have confidence in your battle skills based on this, it's the worst idea ever.
How do you think they're going to celebrate? I mean, I know they shouldn't celebrate, but like, they should do the bar mitzvah thing. Or bat mitzvah in this case, and lift Arya on a chair and just like dance, man. She single-handedly won.
Well, they show a mini celebration in the preview as well, where they're all raising a glass and a toast and stuff like that. So they're all getting hammered for sure. But I don't know, man. Like, Cersei, you can't underestimate Cersei.
I just can't wait. I'm out of predictions for now. I just want the episode to be absorbed a little bit more. I'm going to rewatch it again. We're going to do some wagers. We're going to be doing other breakdowns. Until then, I guess let's just take a breather. I'm gonna save until tomorrow to rewatch the episode. How about you?
Screw the breather, bro. I'm watching it ASAP.
All right, bro. Have fun.
All right, man. All right, man. All right, man.